Pulling up to Mickey D's just for drinks? Oh yeah, that's me. Nothing extra, just perfection and a straw. Coming in hot for the coldest cups on the block. Because there are drinks. Then there are drinks from McDonald's.
Mix things up with any size lemonade or sweet tea for $1.49. Perfect with our classic fries. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba. Pulling up to Mickey D's just for drinks? Oh yeah, that's me. Nothing extra, just perfection and a straw. Coming in hot for the coldest cups on the block. Because there are drinks. Then there are drinks from McDonald's.
Mix things up with any size lemonade or sweet tea for $1.49. Perfect with our classic fries. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
All right, HBCU Legends fans, it's Kyle T. Mosley with Coach Darryl Stewart. We're about to drop some knowledge on you, talk about the SWAC Media Day, as what's happening in HBCU sports.
How you doing?
What's going on, Coach?
How you doing, my friend? Always a pleasure to be with you.
All right, man. Look, man, Tuesday was pretty active out there in Birmingham. You know, they had the Southwestern Athletic Conference Football Media Day, and all the coaches and 24 young men who represented the SWAC as the student athletes were in, I guess, there to be able to answer all the questions, talk about the upcoming season. But we got to start off with some shocking news and surprising news to me. And I don't know how you felt about it, Coach. Was these preseason offensive and defensive player of the year awards, as well as the predictive order of finish for the SWAC. And we'll talk a little bit about that as well. Guys, don't forget, you can be able to follow us online at HBCU Legends at Twitter, or what we call X now, right? X, X.com. At HBCU Legends, as well as IG, as well as Facebook. So you can check us out on those platforms. And you can always go to HBCU.media to be able to read all of the articles from HBCU Legends. All right, Coach, let's talk about it, man. It was interesting to me, you know, the predicted order of finish. And do you want to go by it? Different divisions, East, West, start off there first?
We can.
Yeah, because that was very shocking. Let's start off with the Eastern Division. It wasn't a shock to me that this team was picked first. Alabama State, they had 114 points, and they were picked to be first in that division. What's your thoughts about that?
Yeah, I wasn't shocked at all. You know, Coach Robinson did an outstanding job in the offseason. He needed a signal caller, and he went with the best in the league, which is Andrew Boddy, and he added the missing pieces to the puzzle. And so it wasn't a shocker to me. I thought it was going to be between them and Jackson. And so, you know, let's just see how it pans out.
Yeah, definitely. They were my number one in the East anyway, so that wasn't a shock. Next was Florida A&M, and I was kind of shocked about that one over Jackson State. New head coach Colsey is coming in, and but they've done a lot of activity in the transfer portal as well to be able to kind of restock the young men that they lost from last year's championship team. How do you feel about them coming in second?
Yeah, I kind of thought they would be, since he came in a little bit late in the spring, you know, Coach Simmons left around that January time. I thought maybe Jackson could have been right in that number two spot, but, you know, they put Florida in, you know, in the second spot, which is going to put a lot of pressure on Coach Cozy. And so, you know, let's just see, you know, how well it goes. But around that number two spot, number three spot is where I thought they would be.
Okay. And number three, we talked about it already, T.C. Taylor and the Tigers of Jackson State, coach's alma mater. So those guys came in third, but Cornell Mayer and the guys at Alabama A&M, they came in fourth. And that's about where I had them. What's your feelings about those guys?
Yeah, you know, when I saw Cornelius Manning interview, because I watched all the coaches' interviews, you know, I was very shocked because he looks at himself as the number one leader in the conference right now, the guy that's been in the conference a long period of time as a head coach. And, you know, that seniority leadership, you don't really want to be at the bottom. And, you know, last year was a very disappointing year for Coach Maynard. And now he had a chance to come back, and he had a great interview. But to have him so low like that, you know, I'm sure he's going to come in with a chip on his shoulder. But if not, you know, those programs are under a lot of pressure this season.
Yeah, and he has that stud running back, Mr. Eaglin, back there. So I think they're going to focus on rushing the football this season. And Coach Woody over at Bethune-Cookman had a good interview. I had an opportunity to ask him a couple of questions in the virtual press conference. Very, very direct guy, very to the point. And I like his no-nonsense type of persona, man. And those guys came in fifth right after those guys over at Alabama A&M. Then you had Mississippi Valley State that round out this season's Eastern Division poll rankings. And that's where a lot of people had Mississippi Valley, you know, to be honest, man. It's a struggling program. But get this, Coach. Mississippi Valley came out with one vote for first place.
Really?
Yeah, somebody voted them at first place. I was like, what have the SIDs and coaches been doing? That must be some powerful stuff they smoke. Nah, I'm just kidding, just kidding. So that feels real good for those guys. Eddie Robinson Jr. told me, he said, the goal is to win the SWAC championship and win the Celebration Bowl. I think that's what all the kids are focused on, and we want to be better. And they look like they're about to get better. Andrew Boddy and those guys were in full regalia, you know, looked good, had their gold and black outfits on, their ties, and the ASU symbol on their coats. That's a one thing I like to just kind of point out. This year, it seemed like all of the teams stepped up how they presented themselves. Very professional. I loved it. I loved it. All of them had custom suits on. Did you notice that?
Yeah, they did an outstanding job. All the head coaches did an outstanding job in the interviewing process. You can tell that they listened to us week in and week out. The kids were very knowledgeable. The interviews, they prepped their kids up in the pregame interview part. And so, you know, the coaches, man, hey, man, I know we be hard on, you know, during the season, but kudos to all the head coaches and the players, man. They did an outstanding job getting their kids ready for this big event. And kudos to the commissioner, Kyle. This was probably one of the best media days that I've seen in a long time.
Very well organized, to my understanding. They didn't have too many glitches. They just had some. And I think the glitches from the virtual side was more because of the internet connection than anything else. But other than that, with Tiffany Green and Jay Walker doing the interviews for ESPN Plus, it was great to just have those guys in the mix. And I think congratulations in order to Tiffany Green. Looks like she's pregnant, man. So that is awesome for her and her husband. Right. Let's talk about the West. Now, this is the shocker. And Coach, I know one coach wasn't too happy about this at all.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to start at the bottom on this one, man. We're going to go bottom up on this one. And this coach at the bottom, he wasn't too happy either, man. Texas Southern, only 40 points. They're projected to be dead last in the league as well with the preseason poll. Is that about right for Texas Southern right now?
I'm going to be honest, Kyle. I just think right now that I don't think they will be last. I think they're going to finish the season in that third or fourth spot. I just don't think with the returning team that he has coming back and with his defense being as good as it was last year in that big victory against Alcorn to kick them out of the championship. You know, I just think Coach Dishman is going to bring that NFL experience in there. And I don't think they will finish last. I got them right in that third or fourth spot.
I had to agree with Coach, man. I was just like, ooh, that's low. That's real low. But, you know, a lot of people don't understand the dynamics, what's going on. And we're going to talk about the quarterback situation on a number of these teams as well. But I thought it was pretty low for Coach, but we will go on and talk a little bit more about that later. But Pine Bluff. Now, this one was a shocker to me. Pine Bluff, they had at number 5 in the division. Coach Alonzo Hampton and those guys. I don't think people are going to want to mess with the Golden Lions this year, Coach. What's your thoughts there?
Coach Hampton, outstanding coach, man. Great motivational speaker, did an outstanding job on his interviews. But, you know, it's just the quarterback position is such a question mark right there. And, you know, man, it's, you know what we say, Kyle, if you don't have a quarterback, you don't
pretty have
much
nothing. That's right. But, you know, he did say the young man is coming back. He's returning. The young man who last year he kind of stuck with him. So he is returning to the fold. And the kid was a gamer. I saw it firsthand. Couldn't believe my eyes when Texas Southern, I think they were up 34-10 at one time, at one point in that game. And right, they came back blazing, saddles and all. And they whooped Texas Southern and pretty much sent Coach McKinney packing. That was, I believe, the nail in the coffin for him at Texas Southern. Unfortunately, he's a good guy, man, but that was just something to see how they were able to come back. And those kids were excited after, man, interviewing them after that game. Whew, that was something to see, man. So Coach Hampton, those guys are 5th. Southern University and number 4. Terrence Graves wasn't too happy about that one. Talk about it, Coach.
You hit it right on the nail, Kyle. You know, picking Southern at 4 and knowing what Coach Dooley did of going to the championship, they wasn't pleased with that either. So, you know, it's championship or bust at Southern. And coming in at number 4, that means you won't be there long. And so, you know, that's a tough task at hand. But he has the staff. I'm told he's been recruiting outstanding. So, you know, hey, let's see how it pans out.
Yeah, I think Coach Gray said, you know, I have 3 former head coaches on my staff with Coach McNair, Totten, and I forgot the other. But he said to be able to have those guys to bring some stability in the staff is really good for him as the first-year head coach of Southern University Jaguars. All right, next, Grambling, Mickey Joseph. Man, I was impressed with Mickey. You know, Mickey did a very good job with his interviews. He did a very good job with those young men, Miles Crawley as well, his quarterback. They came in 3rd in the West in the preseason poll. How do you feel about their ranking?
Well, you know what they say, time is not on your side at Grambling. You know, you want to say him coming in late as well that the pressure won't be on. But, you know, releasing Hugh Jackson the way that they did, and, you know, Grambling wants, you got to be in the championship hunt at Grambling. It's a national brand. They have the tools to win. You have people that know they can win if they had their job. And I'm sure Coach Joseph knows that. So, you know, coming in at three, Kyle, I thought he would be in that two spot. But three, I don't think the Grambling fans are too happy about it.
None at all. None at all, man. So that was a good interesting conversation that he had with Jay Walker and Tiffany Green. But also, I believe Coach Joseph has a huge task on his hand. But I think that might be the sweet spot for Grambling this season. Just my opinion. All right. Prairie View A&M at number two. That's right, guys. Not number one. And Bubba McDowell was not. He was hot. He was hot on that one. And Coach had every right to be hot about this one. Cole, man, what were the SIDs and other coaches thinking about this one, man? Tell me. And guys, number one is Alcorn. So we're just going to put it out there. Number one is Alcorn, and number two is Prairie View? What?
Well, you know, this is a pick where I think everybody looked at not only the team, Kyle, but they looked at the fan base. It's tough to go to
all fan base, though. Kyle, what does the fan base have to do with this?
It's like that 12-man, Kyle. You know, you need that fan base camaraderie to build your team up. Because if you look at both teams are even. But, you know, I thought Prairie View should have, you know, by them winning it last year and having everything coming back, I thought they should have been in the number one spot as well. But it didn't happen like that. And now all the pressure is on the Alcorn State Braves.
Lordy, lordy, my. Cole, I don't understand it. And I hear what you say, fan base, but when we talk about Alcorn, we're talking about a brand new coach taking over for Fred McNair, right? We talk about Cedric Thomas. He was a head coach before with Pine Bluff, so he understands how to be a head coach. But at this point, they are like what most of the teams in the whole conference is like without a starter. This was so mind-boggling to me about this, that we had several major teams without naming a starter at quarterback. That was just mind-boggling to me, man.
Yeah.
And we're going to go right into this after that. Guys, we're going to pay some bills right now, so take some time. This is Kyle T. Mosley with Coach Darryl Stewart, Coach Mo, on Blow the Whistle podcast through HBCU Legends. Take care, and we'll be back in a little bit. All right, Coach, we are back, and we've just been going through the predictive order of finishing the Southwestern Athletic Conference for 2024. I wanted you to hear what Bubba McDowell said, if I could just pull this up here.
Right now, we don't have a starter. You know, we got Lucas, they are transferring in from UofH by way of Arkansas. We got Cam Peters, again, that's going to be competing for the job. And you got Jaden Johnson also, who didn't get a chance to play last year, but because due to some situations. So he's got everything right and ready to go this year. Again, they've been out there on their own, throwing with the wide receivers on their own, and man, they all looking good right now. So to say who's going to be the starter at this point remains to be seen, because you know they all.
All right, did you hear that? To say who's the starter right now remains to be seen.
Yeah,
and Terrence Gray said that, and I believe
Grambling too.
Yeah, Mickey Joseph said that, even though he had Miles Crawley there. And Texas Southern said it. You know, at this point, we're talking about less than, a month and a half away from kickoff.
Right.
How comfortable are you as a head coach not knowing or not having an inkling who your starter is going to be?
Well, if you hadn't been an experienced head coach, like some of these guys, it's their first rodeo, they're definitely nervous. But, you know, it's going to take time. Those teams with new quarterbacks, it's not going to happen overnight. They're not junior college guys. Maybe a couple that are transferred in. It's just going to take time, and it's a process, Kyle. You know, hopefully that, you know, the schemes that these offensive coordinators put together. And see, that's where I look at it as a coach. You know, some of the staffs on these teams with new head coaches are very experienced. So that's going to take them over the course and period of time of getting better, you know, with the new quarterbacks and the new system. How well can the system gel with the coaching staff? That's the way I look at it.
Yeah, and new systems, new coaches, new players, new starters is going to be – do you think that's going to give us a good product on the field that we're going to say, let's be great and anxious to go buy a ticket? Or is the parity something that we have to cringe and hope to see a good product on the field?
Well, by listening to the coaches in the interviews, you know, most of the coaches have their teams on campus in the summer. And so, therefore, the product should be up to standards when it comes to that first game. I do know if you don't have your team on campus in the summer, you're in trouble. And so most of those coaches, when you listen to the interview, all of their team majorities are on campus, especially the starters. They're working out. They're getting better. And so they understand the HBCU fan base. They understand what they have to do to keep it going and win the championship, Kyle.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I know Coach Terrence Gray's talked about Mark Frederick as his offensive coordinator. He feels very comfortable there. And I think the wide receiver, the young man, was very direct and to the point. He said, we have no choice but for our offense to get better. I loved it. He said, we ain't got no choice for it to get better, man. So that was a good interview that young man had. So let's just go over, recap the whole order of finish that has been predicted by the SIADs as well as the head coaches. And let's start at the bottom. Texas Southern 12, Pine Bluff 11, Southern 10th, Grambling 9th, Prairie View 8th. Remember that, guys. Prairie View 8, Alcorn State 7, Mississippi Valley 6. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
What? Okay. Maybe it's me, man. Coach, you don't sound too shocked. But anyway, 5th, Bethune-Cookman. Alabama A&M 4th, Jackson State 3rd, Florida A&M 2nd, and Alabama A&M 1st.
Right.
Wow. That was just that's something, man. So anyway, I think Prairie View should be a little bit higher, in my opinion. And Coach McDowell and his guys, they got that chip on their shoulder now, man. So we're just going to see how this translate out in the beginning of the games that they kick off is at home at Prairie View against Texas Southern. His friend, of course, Chris Dishman and the Tigers of Texas Southern will be rolling in up to 90 to be able to visit those guys. Now, let's talk about the preseason offensive and defensive players of the year. For offense, Miles Crawley from Grambling State. But as we just said, Mickey Joseph said he doesn't have a starter.
Right.
What gives? Talk to me, Coach.
Well, you know, every new head coach, Kyle, I don't care what they say, you know, they want their own guys.
Mm.
And I mean, Miles Crawley, was a Hugh Jackson guy. Mm-hmm. You want Mickey Joseph as a top recruiter. He's going to want his own players. Me personally, Kyle, I thought that was a big blow to say. I don't know if I would have said that because Miles Crawley is arguably the best, second best quarterback in the conference behind Andrew Boddy. Now, as I said, I don't know if I would have said that because if he doesn't end up being a starter and you bench him or you go with somebody else, you got to understand this kid has built a repertoire at Grambling, you know, and he's been there now. He knows the fan base, team has rallied around him. And now that you come in as a head coach and you say you don't have a quarterback, that you know, I don't know if that's sending a message to him to get better or that he's probably not going to be the starter. And so, like I said, every head coach has their own philosophy. I don't know if I would have said that knowing the type of reputation he has in the conference, because clearly if you bench him, you probably going to have to cut him because he's going to, I mean, people, it's going to be kind of like that. You remember when Alcorn, Coach McNair, I think it was Footman, came in and somebody got benched that was pretty good.
Mm. Well, and I feel you, Coach, and I understand that. But what was kind of perplexing to me was the fact that he's on stage, he's talking to Tiffany Green, he's talking to Jay Walker, and a few feet away from him are the two kids sitting there with Miss Simone about to be interviewing, and you hear that my coach just did not give me a vote of confidence.
Right.
Psychologically, right. What does that do to you as a player?
That's what I'm saying. You know, knowing him, being the reputation that he has in the conference, you know, he's been there. You know, Grambling was so close with Hugh Jackson of getting over the hump, but they did it with Miles Crowell. And so, I just, as a player, what I'm thinking right now is I'm either going to either work harder or to get better so he won't have no excuse not to play me. But I'm trying to really stay focused because knowing that your head coach said that you're not going to be the starter, it just kind of creates another narrative, Kyle. You know, what is he thinking? Is the kid from Jacksonville, like everybody's, you know, a lot of people are hearing great things about the kid from Jacksonville State. And so, you know, I don't know. I don't know Coach Joe's philosophy, but I do know as a head coach, I probably wouldn't have said that.
And but like I'm with you, and I agree with you, but it kind of exasperates the issue that now he's the preseason offensive player of the year.
Right.
I'm just like, makes you like, no, Scooby Doo. Yeah. I don't know about that, Shaggy. But anyway, man, just crazy, dude. And Kelby Givens, the defensive lineman from Southern, he's the defensive player of the year. Smart kid after listening to his conversations, man. Real smart kid. I like him. Let's talk about the preseason All-SWAC. Let's just talk about the first team. Quarterback Miles Crawley, running backs are going to be Eaglin from Alabama A&M and Kendrick Rimes from Southern University. Those two make sense.
Right.
Those two, I think right now, if I had to say those are two of the top guys in the whole conference, it's probably all HBCU. I would have to say those two could possibly be neck and neck this whole year. The offensive lineman, Grable from FAMU, Dunn from Alabama State, Henry from Jackson State, Martin from Grambling State, and Church from Mississippi Valley. The receivers, Fabian McCray from Jackson State and Jacoby Hewitt from Alabama A&M. Now, I know Hewitt. I don't know McCray. Do you know much about his game over at Jackson State?
A great tweener receiver. I thought this was kind of weird because of what Rico Powell has done, and he's the number one guy at Jackson. We all know that. But, you know, Fabian McCray is an outstanding receiver. He can play inside and out. And so, but I this was a strange one to me. You know, I wouldn't say he's better than Rico Powell, but, you know, hey, the voters thought so. So congratulations to him. But great receiver, and hope he gets the job done.
Okay. And Alcorn State has the tight end, Mr. Tavarius Griffin. That rounds up the first team offense. First team defense, defensive lineman Bailey from Alcorn State, Givens from Southern, Thomas from Alabama State, and Presley from Prairie View A&M. Another impressive young man. I like the way he thinks and he communicates. The linebackers were Rico Dozier from Alabama State, which makes sense. That kid was a tackling machine last year, man. He was all over the place, boy. He and Colton Adams, that they made a good tandem. And Jacob Williams from Texas Southern made it as a linebacker, as well as Cunningham from Alabama State. So Alabama State coach Robinson has, you know, he's an old linebacker. He got two of his guys at linebacker for the first team defense. What's your thoughts there?
Well, like you said, he's a defensive guy. And Coach Robinson played linebacker. He did it at a high level, was an outstanding player at Alabama State and the NFL. So he knows how to coach. And I give him credit for that. You know, Kyle, you always, as a head coach, he's one of those guys that coach linebackers and the head coach, because he doesn't want you to say he's not doing his job. Right. But clearly he's doing an outstanding job, because two of his guys at his position are first team. So he's doing an outstanding job, man. And hey, Alabama State is on the top right now, and hopefully they end up at the in the championship game, Kyle.
Yeah, definitely. The four defensive backs are Kendall Bowler from Florida A&M, which that should have been automatic, in my opinion. Pate from Alabama A&M, he's one of the guys. Burgess from Alabama State, as well as Wilson from Florida A&M. Looks like Alabama State from one, two, three, four guys are on the first team defense from Alabama State, which makes sense because they were the top defense last season as well in that Eastern Division. No, I take that back. They were right behind Florida A&M as the top defense, but I think they surrendered less yards than Florida A&M did. So the specialist, the first team specialist, Florida A&M's Gillis as the place kicker, punter Noel from Jackson State, return specialist Mac Mim from Alabama State, and long snapper Blackwell from Southern University. All right, that rounds up the first team. Anybody missed the mark or missed the team that you thought should have been on that first team?
Well, I thought Malachi Bailey, the defensive end, should have been Defensive Player of the Year. I thought it was going to be him. But the young man from Southern is a great player as well. But, you know, I measure great players out of championships, Kyle. He has two. He's been a starter, four-year starter. Some people projected him to go into the NFL. And so I just thought he was, you know, worthy of that preseason Defensive Player of the Year.
All right, Coach. Who do you think is the second team quarterback? Just take a shot. Just give me a name that should be there.
On second team, I probably would take Noah from Southern.
Not Andrew Boddy.
Well, but he's already first team on the other side, right?
Nope. That was Miles Crawley.
Yeah. Wow. Oh no, I would have taken I would have taken Andrew without a doubt.
Yeah, well, it's his successor, Jace Wilson of Texas Southern. They named him the second team offensive quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
I know that's getting to Mr. Body Boy. Woo.
Yeah. Jace, a great young quarterback. He out of God. The kid, the only thing that people say about Jace Wilson is his size.
Yeah.
But truly, he's a great Russell Wilson for the swag. I mean, man, he makes all the throws, man.
Yeah.
He can throw downfield. He can throw short passes. And the thing about it is he doesn't make a lot of mistakes.
Yeah.
So,
you know, Archie Manning, I had an opportunity to speak to Archie Manning, the GOAT from the SEC. And he, of course, he produced GOATs, Peyton and Eli. But Archie handpicked Jace and Miles Crawley to participate at the Manning Passing Academy camp that they had this past year. And it's the 28th year that they had it. So I asked him, why Jace? He said, you know, he took a look at his background. He took a look at what he was done from Fordham coming over to Texas Southern and being the newcomer of the year for the SWAC last year. He wanted to give him an opportunity to come on in and be able to showcase his skills and teach these young guys. So kudos to him, Archie, for what he's done to reach back into the HBCUs and be able to kind of showcase these young men, you know. So that's pretty good there. Another guy that I thought could have been on that first team was, let's see, the young man from Jackson State, Esaias Guthrie. He's second team defensive back. You've talked about him a number of times. Why do you think he was dropped a little bit lower compared to these other young men who were first teamers?
I think it's the standard. I mean, the standard at Jackson State, Southern, Grambling, you know, are championship standards. And when, you know, those guys that know they should be first team and they're not there, sometimes they say, well, let's see how hungry he is. And I just think that probably played a big part in, you know, putting some of these kids that should have been first team on second team.
Okay. All right. All right, guys, we're going to take a little break and we should be back in a few minutes. I'm Kyle T. Mosley of HBCU Legends. That's Coach Darryl Stewart. We will be back with our final thoughts about the SWAC Media Day, as well as talk a little bit about what's happening with the MEAC SWAC Challenge. All right, we are back with HBCU Legends. I'm Kyle Mosley with Darryl Stewart. Coach, man, any final thoughts about what happened with the Media Day for the SWAC?
Like I said, man, I thought this was one of the best media days ever, you know, by losing Coach Prime. I thought all our kid coaches spoke well, players spoke well. They came out ready to perform. And when you're on a big stage like that, you know, you want to be ready. And they did an outstanding job. The commissioner did an outstanding job. And I think, Kyle, what a lot of people were saying after this media day, maybe the commissioner should do more of this, you know, because it's obvious that our coaches and players can do it. And so, you know, we had a Zoom with the coaches, but, you know, the commissioner gave a great speech. You know, when you look at all the other commissioners, Greg Sankey gave a great speech with the SEC, but the commissioner, he talked.
Pulling up to Mickey D's just for drinks? Oh yeah, that's me. Nothing extra, just perfection and a straw. Coming in hot for the coldest cups on the block. Because there are drinks. Then there are drinks from McDonald's.
Mix things up with any size lemonade or sweet tea for $1.49. Perfect with our classic fries. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba. Pulling up to Mickey D's just for drinks? Oh yeah, that's me. Nothing extra, just perfection and a straw. Coming in hot for the coldest cups on the block. Because there are drinks. Then there are drinks from McDonald's.
Mix things up with any size lemonade or sweet tea for $1.49. Perfect with our classic fries. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
Told you why he was moving tournaments. He told you about budgeting. And he talked a lot of great things. And so I think that's what our fans wanted to hear. He delivered on that. And so I thought this was one of the best media days ever.
Okay. Let's hear from Commissioner Dr. Charles McClellan talking about the new digital network that the SWAC is going to bring in 2024.
You know, we do hear our constituents, and part of the delay on the SWAC digital network is that we wanted to make sure that we had a first-class, first-quality broadcast. We did not want to just put anything out. So that is the reason why we were meticulous in choosing our partners, ESPN, HBCU, and even Woodlawn Entertainment, that we chose to carry SWAC Digital Network. We want to do things at a high level, and that is the reason why we were able to get the deals that we got, because we put a quality product out. People saw, we were able to establish what that value and what that worth was, and that's ultimately why we are where we are. So we want to do things correctly in a meticulous manner to give it a first-class look and a first-class feel, and that is the reason why we're doing it now, and that's the reason why we will expand.
All right. What's your thoughts about that? The SWAC Digital Network will pick up all of the other games that are not going to be on HBCU Go, ESPN as well.
Like I said, you know, he gave a great deliverance of talking about expansion with not just the network, but all the teams getting them more visible on networks, creating a bigger revenue than what he already has. And so this is a way for him to have extra revenue channels within the conference and to also grow the conference. And so you can't do it without the funds and the money. And this is another outstanding tool, Kyle, for all our schools to really have television coverage and to be seen by everybody. It's just outstanding.
All right. I got to play this exchange between myself and Coach Dishman. I know you guys are rocking and ready for the Labor Day Classic, but you talked about this is not just about one game. It's about the whole season, how you guys are preparing for that. Talk about your team, talk about your staff, and what you have seen thus far from the Tigers.
Well, first and foremost, we got out of spring ball with no injuries. We got everybody back for the summer. Our guys are ready and excited to play and start the season. Now, what I have to do is calm my guys down and tell them that we can't win versus Prairie View tomorrow. We can't win. Just calm down. And it's a process we have to do to get there.
It's a process to get there. He's saying he feels as though his team, they're ready. They're ready to shoot off and get off on Prairie View, man. Coach was pretty excited about his outlook, especially going against his good friend. He called Bubba McDonald is not just a good friend, is his brother. So, right. You know, that was pretty good. I apologize for what was happening in the background. Can you believe we had one guy who kept his mic on the whole time and he walked around?
Wow.
And they were trying to get him to shut it down and shut it down. I was like, man, just kick him out. So it was giving us some poor feedback there, but that's what Coach Dishman was talking about. All right, Coach, let's talk about the SWAC going against the MEAC. You know, historically, they haven't done very well over the years, but last year they had two wins in the MEAC SWAC Challenge as well as the Celebration Bowl. This season at the MEAC SWAC Challenge is going to be Coach Cozy going against Dawson Odom, of course, of Norfolk State, and the FAMU Rattlers are going to play in week zero. How do you see that game, man?
Well, you know, it's just ever since Coach Odoms has stepped foot at Norfolk, man, it hasn't been good. Clearly, he's a winner. He's a championship guy. And for some strange reason, you know, when you take over these losing programs, Kyle, you know, Eddie Robinson used to always tell me, the great Eddie Robinson, once a loser, always a loser. Ooh. He used to say that, and I couldn't figure that out, Kyle. You know, sometimes, you know, taking these programs sometimes is not, you know, hey, you probably want to wait it out. I don't, you know, but they paid them well. But it's definitely not. I would say this in Coach Odoms' defense, it's not him. I mean because taking Southern to the championship, what, 4 out of 5 times, and then you go to a program and try to revitalize it. I mean, it's just tough to do, man, if everybody's not on board. And I see this game. I mean, maybe a 28-14. FAMU, I think they're going to win it. You know, Virginia is really not a football state, and so it makes it tough. You know, you got to go into these programs, especially when they're not a football state, and become a national brand in recruiting. And so you got to have the budget to recruit now. NIL is probably hurting them, Kyle. They're in a tougher situation. You know, they're in basketball country. And so it's just tough, man. It's tough on Coach Odoms. But hopefully he ends up in the winning column on his last year of his contract.
Yeah. Coach slimmed down. He's looking good and feeling good. But the Spartans have a tough schedule this year, man.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's not going to be easy, especially with Trey Oliver and Chinnis Berry there. And And Damon Wilson, can't forget about him as well. Those guys are going to put some good quality football out there. It's going to be very competitive. And we can't forget Larry Scott. You know, what he did. He brought this team to the Celebration Bowl last season.
Right. And, you know, you can look at what Coach Scott did. Even though he took Turner Howard around, you know, they ended up, what, 7-4. Mm-hmm. And so that was a process as well. He just didn't go in there and do it. I think he was on his third or fourth season. But, you know, it just takes time. And most of our schools really don't give you time, Kyle. So, you know, hopefully these guys come in and do what they need to do to be on top.
You said it all, really, right there.
What's that?
Nobody is giving people time to develop any longer, man.
Right.
And I think it was Bill Polian I heard on the NFL Network, and he was talking about this. He said the problem has been, especially in the National Football League, is that everybody wants that immediate success. And if they don't see the immediate success, they want to go on to the next person, go on to the next person until we find it. And they give them a shelf life of, what, 2 to 3 years. That's what the average NFL coach is going for right now, right? And if you're a black coach, you might just be 1 year. So, 1 year. Yeah. So, and it's tough, man. It's very tough what's happening these days. And I think it has translated down to college football too. You see how some of the even Power Four schools, they don't wait. They don't wait. You know, right. They're paying a guy millions of dollars to produce. They would like to see the W's and make the fan base very, very, very happy. So,
all right. Now, you know, I'm gonna say this to the athletic directors in our northern schools, like Ohio and Norfolk. You know, especially when you have the coaches, but you know, you might be in those basketball areas. And you know, NIL is into play now, and it's tougher to recruit kids. Man, and you take the coach at Morgan State, an outstanding young head coach, but he didn't do outstanding last year. He did, you know, he won some good games, but I just think it takes time in those basketball areas, you know, as far as school. When you know you're not a football program, it takes time. We have to be realistic. And now we have to work on getting these budgets. I kind of agree with these coaches, Kyle. If you know you don't have NIL money, if you know your budget is not intact, you're going to have to at least give me 3-4 years, Kyle, before you fire me. Is that fair? I'm asking you. You've been on both the CEO side, and how would you look at that?
Man, that's a great question, because I remember I'm telling you from personal experience, man, I would have been fired. They wouldn't even say, Kyle, you're fired. They would just been packing up my stuff while I'm still working. That's how terrible my first year as a manager was as a recruiter, man. And it wasn't until the end of my second year that things started to gel. And you know why?
Why?
I started doing it my way.
Yeah.
Instead of doing it the way everybody told me to do it. It wasn't working. I had to do it like I had to build a team. I had all the people that they didn't want. I had to work with those guys, train them, build them up, and have them to understand that they have the capability. That next year, we outbuilt everybody in the whole corporation. We're talking about 44 agencies across the U.S., and I was manager of the year. So, yeah, if they didn't give me time, I would never have been able to say I was manager of the year for a whole corporation. Right. Think about that, man. So I think that really plays into what we really need to talk about is leadership. Leadership is necessary, but also leadership takes time to groom and develop. Coach Belichick was a terrible first couple of leaders at Cleveland and the Jets and other places, right?
Right.
Bill Parcells, it took him a little while to gel as the New York Giants head coach. So those things take time if you actually believe you have somebody who's capable of being the leader. Do you have the patience, like you said, to be able to watch them develop?
Right.
All right, let's talk about Tiffany Dawn Sykes. Congratulations to the VP and athletic director of Florida A&M. She's been named the Women's Leaders Nike Division 1 FCS Executive of the Year. Wow.
Yeah, big award, Kyle. You know, all the things that she's been under and fam, you know, the transition, coming into that AD role, winning in her first year with Coach Simmons. And, you know, just all the adversity she's been around while she's been at FAM. And now she has a big award to go on her resume and to probably add more incentives for FAMU and whoever the new president to keep her there, huh?
Well, I mean, she's brought in, what, national championships, baseball championships, couple other little championships, golf or tennis or something to that nature. She's done a tremendous job over the past couple of seasons. Yeah, I think keeping her would be a wise choice at this time, in my opinion. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, I have to agree with you, man. You know, most by working with most women, and, you know, most women would have packed up the bags and left, Kyle. But she's a tough cookie. she does it her way now. but you know, Kyle, and you made a great point, Kyle, about doing it your way. But I wanted to hit a great bullet point for you when you look at the situation that North Carolina Central is in. I mean, when you do it your way, are you kind of asking for trouble? Or are you just saying, I'm a bet on me? And whether how this thing goes, whether I get fired or whether I, you know, sign an extension, I'm just going to bet on me. How would you, you know, take that approach?
With North Carolina Central is a different story. What I'm talking about, do it my way, was to how I was going to manage my team.
Right.
How I was going to build my team. And you see, Trey Oliver just that. He did it his way to build that program. When it comes to that athletic department, I think that's going to be up to Dr. Skip Perkins to kind of figure out how he wants that department to look. And I think he's still feeling it out right now. You know, when you hear him speak, he's a very smart guy. So I think also you may have to give him an opportunity to kind of resolve some of these issues that he was faced with when he first took the job, and give him an opportunity this season to kind of wipe some of that slate clean and be able to chart a new direction for his athletic department. So I think that's the route I would go if I was the administration.
Right. And great point. You know, I was just looking at now, man, every true CEO and true leader wants to do it their way. Mm-hmm. But I was thinking this new generation of time, you got to be very careful, man. It's so much negotiating that is going on now. It's not easy. Mm-hmm. It's your team versus my team, your state versus my state. Everybody's in competition and nobody's trustworthy. So you got to be on your P's and Q's. So I don't know, Kyle. I don't know if I would go that my way route. But, you know, hey, like I say, every true leader have their own philosophy. But
you got to be like, Frankie, baby. I did it my way. Look, man, it worked for me. That's the only thing I know. And every time I've led a system or a team of people, like I lead the Saints News Network, as well as when I built it up, all these years, I had to be able to do it and have that sense that I was doing it the way that I can appreciate and feel like I left no stone unturned. So that's what I'm talking about. All right, let's talk about this before we get on off the air. Two HBCU baseball players were selected in the Major League Draft this past couple of days ago, and that's Alabama State's Randy Flores and Kenyon Brown from North Carolina A&T. Congratulations, young men. Last year, I think we only had one young man from A&T that was selected. And the year before that, nobody. So, little progress. But Coach, what was kind of shocking to me, in the UFL college draft today, absolutely not one, not an iota of an HBCU player was drafted. What's your thoughts, man?
Yeah, man. Just because what these players have to understand, just because you don't make it to the NFL doesn't mean you stop training. It's all sorts of leagues that are out there. It's up to you to put yourself around the right sports agency, the right sports team, so you can keep developing and training. So your time will come. Now, we have a great former HBCU coach in the UFL, Coach Barlow.
Right.
So we have a pipeline to working out. You know, you have to do your job as a player when you know you want to play professional football. And so they had several of combines across the Southeast region. I think they went all over, Kyle.
Mm-hmm. They did.
Yeah, I mean, it's just no excuse anymore, man. You know, with the players, everybody's getting paid now. You have to put yourself around the right team, save your money. You know you got flights, or you know you got to go work out for teams now. It's just no excuse, man. And if you want to play professional football, it's wide open more than it's ever been, Kyle. So, I mean, hey. I don't think it's their fault. I just think we have to be more knowledgeable and have a plan, an action plan ready for our student athletes.
Okay. I looked at some of those guys who were drafted. I'm pretty sure some of our HBCU guys were just as well prepared to be able to enter that draft. Just my opinion. All right.
Right. I didn't know where is he in the Canadian League, the former linebacker that was at Jackson?
I don't know. You're talking about Miller. Yeah, he went to the Canadian League.
Okay. Okay.
He's in Canadian.
By guys that haven't got picked up yet, the only ones that I know really right now that were NFL prospect was the big cornerback at Alabama State, Victor.
Victor, right. Victor, yeah.
I mean, I don't. I think everybody else is playing, right?
I think so. If I'm not mistaken, a couple of these guys may have an opportunity when training camp come up to get on some of those NFL rosters, because you know injury is going to happen left and right.
Right.
Some of the rookies have already started to report. And especially like the Saints, Bub Means, the rookie wide receiver out of Pittsburgh, he reported had a foot injury, so they're keeping him off the roster for a bit until they kind of play that out. So things like that happen, you know.
And Musa is with the Tampa
Bay Bucks. right.
So, you know, man, it's, I don't know, Kyle. I think all of our kids are, you know, in great spots. You know, I don't know. Like I say, Miller has gotten picked up. So, you know, you do have anybody out there. I hadn't heard of anything about the running back from Auckland.
He's with the Green Bay Packers.
Okay.
And Terrell Jennings, the running back from Florida A&M, is with the Patriots.
Well, there you have it.
Yeah, so
that's probably why the UFL hadn't signed him.
I can understand why someone didn't take a flyer on both of those guys a lot sooner, especially during the HBCU Combine. But Terrell Jennings wasn't even invited to the Combine. Now, if you saw how that kid played for Willie Simmons, that was just kind of puzzling to me, you know? So, but he's with somebody. He has this opportunity. Now he has this opportunity to showcase in front of Coach Mayo and see if he can be able to earn a spot with the Patriots. And last thing, guys, if you are a gamer, I'm not a gamer. Coach, you're a gamer? You like to do those EA sports games and stuff?
Well, I mean, you know, I like to watch them, but you know, I'm not a gamer.
Like my son used to try to get me to play. I was like, hey, man, you got to teach dad how to do all these buttons and stuff. That's not for me, man. I came with the little one stick playing Pac-Man or Galaza. That's all I play, man. Galaga, whatever they called it. Those were my two games, man. So anyway, not one HBCU team is going to be a part of the EA Sports College Football 25 video game. But there's a workaround, but there's a way to work around it. And a couple of the sites have already posted ways you could be able to download the Florida A&M guys, the Jackson State guys, and who I think there's another HBCU team that they've figured out how to download these guys into your game console. So go out there, take a look. I don't know anything about it, so I can't give you any advice. So just have some fun, guys. Any last thoughts, Coach?
Yeah, I wanted to say this, Kyle. We, man, it was so many people listening to our, first of all, congratulations. I know it's not your first rodeo, but on my end, you got 40,000 views, man. 60,000 views.
Yeah, 60. Yeah.
That particular show was unbelievable, man. And, you know, Sports Illustrated, your end on the bargain, man. Just all what you do for HBCU Legends, man. I'm very, very deeply thankful and I appreciate it. So many people proud of us for hitting 60,000 views, man. Outstanding. But I want to hit you with this before we go. We had some listeners out of the Atlanta area.
Uh-oh.
And they Clark Atlanta leadership team in their leadership department is partnering with Harvard University to create great leaders. They see the trend in leadership and presidents. So they're going to have a program to come out. I want to say, if not the fall, definitely in the spring semester, where you can go in and they will train you to be a CEO/president. So I thought that was outstanding on Clark's part. Kudos to the administration and the people in the lovely city of Atlanta, Georgia. Always, man, in Atlanta, man, you know, Black Hollywood, Kyle. I mean, to do that, man, I just think that's outstanding. If you want to be a top CEO or president at one of our campuses, them partnering with Harvard, it's going to be outstanding. And, you know, for us being in Louisiana, now you can go to Clark and get into a top program and then end up being a president at one of our institutions. I just thought that was amazing.
It is. It is amazing. I think it's a great way to go. And kudos to them for being able to bring that out. Before we go, also another kudos to King Griffey Jr. Can't speak enough of the legend, what he's done for HBCUs. He didn't even attend the HBCU, but this is the second season for the HBCU Swingman Classic that they had last week, right before the All-Star game. And two of the Grambling State Tigers, they won the MVPs and the Impact Awards for their participation. So kudos to them and what they've been able to do as well. But just to bring that out, and those two young men that were drafted, get this, they were in that game. So that's great. That's really great.
Also, Kyle, you know, our condolences Jacoby Jones and his family.
Yeah, I was about to go on that. Yeah, go ahead.
Former HBCU great, former Lane College great, outstanding wide receiver, man. And the Kobe Jelly Beans Bryant father as well, man, the Bryant family. Oh, man, you know, just devastating news back-to-back like that for our African-Americans. And, man, you know, kudos and prayers, man, you know. Two warriors that did it the right way. Outstanding, outstanding people, man. You just never know, Kyle.
You never know, and you just got to stay prayed up, and you got to love the people that is part of your life, man. And a lot of people take each other for granted, but one thing you can't do is say tomorrow is assured for you. Right. It's not. But Jacoby, he's an HBCU legend, and of course what he did in the Super Bowl in New Orleans in front of his family, those right. Two touchdowns that he had against the San Francisco 49ers, the record that he set for that kickoff return, that's still a record today for the NFL Super Bowl of 104 yards, something to that nature.
It's still in place, right?
Still in place. Hasn't been broken, man. And he was just a joyful young guy. And, you know, that's what Coach – let me go. I'm going to read the words from Coach Eddie Robinson on the passing. I had to ask him. I started off the press conference that way. I say, before we even talk about the – team, what's your thoughts about Jacoby Jones? And he said Jacoby was just a great guy who he made everybody smile when he walked into the room. He said a small story here. My dad was had a security company, and he still does. And they would do security for Xavier University, where Jacoby's mom worked. And he remembered Jacoby since he was a little kid, around 10 years old. So he lived a great life, and he definitely played for his mom and his son, who he loved very much. And we're going to miss him, and we love him. And he did have a short life of 40 years. He did. He had a short life, but he also made the most of his life. He was very impactful. Jacoby came from Lane Dragons. He was coached by Johnny Cole there, man. Yeah, Johnny Cole had him.
Brothers.
Yeah, yeah. He had him ready for the NFL. drafted in the third round by the Houston Texans, the 73rd overall pick of the 2007 NFL draft. He caught 203 receptions for 2,733 yards and 14 touchdowns in 9 seasons with the Texans, Ravens, Chargers, and Steelers. But get this, he not only did that, he had 4 punt returns for a touchdown as well as 5 kickoff returns for touchdowns in his career. That's Hall of Fame worthy, isn't it not? That's kind of close to what Devin Hester had.
Yeah, man. And, you know, you just know players coming out of the cities like Atlanta, New Orleans, Houston, they're going to have a lot of NFL guys. And, man, those guys in the cities that these guys come from, they rely on their voice a lot. And so, you know, Jacoby was one of them, man, a very loving person. Everybody knew him. And so, you know, man, just, you know, like I said, Kyle, you just never know, man. And so kudos to his family. But, you know, if there's anything that we can do, just let us know and we'll get it done, Kyle.
Yeah, prayers to his mom, his son, the rest of the family. It's 108 yards was his second half kickoff return for a touchdown that extended the lead for the Ravens over San Francisco. But it was that touchdown also that kind of turned the tides for the Ravens in that game, if I recall. Even though he had, get this, he had over 208 yards in 5 kickoffs in that game. All right. He had probably, I think they say, close to 300 yards of offense in the game. Right. But they still gave the MVP to the quarterback, Joe Flacco.
Hey, what we say, if you don't have a quarterback, you don't have nothing.
Yeah, well, the Ravens, if they didn't have Jacoby Jones that game. And we can't forget about this. Remember that, was it the AFC Championship game or was the divisional game against Denver? Yeah, it's the divisional game against Denver. Remember, it was him on that miracle pass to Jacoby for that touchdown that tied the game so they could go into overtime.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. So Jacoby was the man for them that whole playoffs run that they had for the second Ravens Super Bowl ring. All right. And while we're on it, man, let's just kind of wrap up here. CIAA predicted finish for 2024. Virginia State, number one. Union is number two. Fayetteville State, number three. And Johnson C. Smith, number four. Wow. And Bowie State, number five. That wraps up the top five for the CIAA. And I think...
You mean tell me Winston-Salem State is not?
Winston-Salem State was ranked number six.
Wow.
Shaw, number seven. Lincoln in Pennsylvania, eight. Livingstone, now that's a shot. Livingstone really doesn't have that good of a team sometimes. Number nine, Elizabeth City State, 10th. And Bluefield State, which is just getting back in the swing of things. Now, they had decent showing a couple of games last year, so I don't know what's happening. But those bottom teams, Bluefield, and they're, you know, under flux. They're new leadership, new coaching staffs, and things of that nature. So that might have a lot to do with their projection. All right, Coach, any last words, thoughts, criticisms?
No, Kyle, you know, I want to give the SEC, it's something was different about their media days, being in Dallas, not in Hoover. I just think it should go back to Hoover. But when I ranked the media days, I had Big 12 1, SEC 2, and the SWAC right in that top five at 3, man. And I thought that was just outstanding. Most voters had the SWAC. Some people had them at 2 and 3. When you look at all the media days that's going on, I just think, Kyle, we're on the right track and the best is yet to come, man. And So it's football time.
It's football time. Next week, the MEAC will have their media day in Norfolk at the Hilton Norfolk. And it's going to be jam-packed. They start off at 12 o'clock as far as the show with ESPN. The media day interviews will commence around 9 a.m. in the morning for the media that will be there in participation. Of course, Norfolk State will face Florida A&M in the annual cricket MEAC SWAC Challenge, and that's going to take place at Central Park Stadium in Atlanta, Georgia, and that's going to be a good game. It's going to be broadcast on ABC, not ESPN. That's pretty good as well. So I know that was one thing that John Grant from ESPN told me this year. The Celebration Bowl as well as the MEAC SWAC Challenge will be on ABC. And to have both of those big productions for our HBCUs there is great to see. So, all right, Coach, we are going to call it a night. Guys, if you want to follow us again, you can follow us online. But, Coach, first, tell everybody how they can find you on the World Wide Web.
Yeah, hit me up at Coach Stewart Tycoon League 2, the number 2 at gmail.com. I'm already getting emails right now and on a lovely show. Hey, Kyle, you know we can't forget about it. Let's thank all our 60,000-plus listeners. I mean, fans, we love you. We love what you do. We love that you take the time out in your day to listen to us. It's a blessing. And always, when you see me in the galleries or out, hey, if you want a picture, that's fine, or whatever you want, because never forget, Kyle, we love the fans.
You sound like Martin. Martin loved the kids.
He loved our fans, man.
Oh, my God. That's funny. Coach and I will be back with Ralph Cooper on his show talking about HBCU sports next month. We're taking a little hiatus there, and you can be able to check us out on KCOH AM with Ralph Cooper on around 6, 7 o'clock p.m. on every Tuesday night through the season. All right, Coach.
Appreciate you, my friend.
HBCU Legends, check us out online at HBCU Legends on Facebook, Twitter, IG. You can check me out at KTMOZE. That's Kyle Mosley from HBCU Legends. Check me out on Twitter at KTMOZE. And you can also... there's one thing. We have a new sister site that we're launching, and it's been doing pretty well throughout the summer, Black Sports Insiders. So go to Black Sports Insiders, and you can check out some of the writings from myself. And I got some special interviews that I'm going to post there from Ricky Williams that talked about the cannabis industry. So Ricky... He's blazing it up. He's sparking greatness. That's his tagline for his business, the Heisman business, and that's H-I-G-H-S-M-A-N, the Heisman. And so you can check us out there at Black Sports Insiders. Again, my name is Kyle T. Mosley. That's Coach Darryl Stewart. Coach, thank you, sir.
No problem, my friend.
All right. Thank you, guys. Take care.
Be warned that once you pick up a refreshingly cold drink from McDonald's and people see just how refreshingly cold that drink from McDonald's is, you may create drink envy. Because there are drinks, then there are drinks from McDonald's.
For a morning brew that really creates a stir, get any size iced coffee, including caramel and French vanilla, for just 99 cents before 11 a.m. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
Pulling up to Mickey D's just for drinks? Oh yeah, that's me. Nothing extra, just perfection and a straw. Coming in hot for the coldest cups on the block. Because there are drinks. Then there are drinks from McDonald's.
Mix things up with any size lemonade or sweet tea for $1.49. Perfect with our classic fries. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.